Hey, this is Dan Briggs from Between the Barry to Me, and you're watching Under the Gun TV. So last night you guys started this tour in Virginia with Deaf Heaven, Intronaut, and The Kindred. How did night one go? It was sold out, right?
Yeah, it was great. We played really well, which doesn't always happen on the first day or the first handful of days even. But played tight, felt good, the crowd was great, and the bands we're on tour with are super awesome. So yeah, it was a good start.
This is an interesting combination of bands. How did this tour package come together?
Well, whenever we're planning a tour, we always throw out, you know, the names of so many different bands and try to see what sticks between, you know, our booking agent and manager and, you know, ideas that they have. And, The Kindred were a band that were brought to us, to check out, and, we really dug them, and we thought they'd be great on the tour. And Intronaut, is a band whose name we've thrown around for a couple of years, and they're definitely one of the more interesting heavy bands out there right now. Really cool dynamics in their music. And then Deaf Heaven, you know, is a band that I got into last year when they put out their newest record, and you know, I just thought they were so cool, and you know, they just create really cool moods with their music, you know, really different. And thankfully, they weren't turned off by the offer from us, and they were into it, and they're really cool guys, so it's a neat package.
I was checking out your guys' Facebook page today, and you were saying how excited you were to play at the Paramount, because it's a relatively new venue, you've never been here before. The first time I saw you guys play Long Island, it was basically a floor show, and it was probably a 20th the size of this place. Mm-hmm. What are your vibes from this venue so far?
It's great. It's a very professional venue, you know, very nice. And pretty big. I don't know. It should be awesome though. The show from out front looks rad as far as the lights and our video stuff. It looks really cool. So yeah, it should be good.
Are there any stops that you have planned on this tour that you're excited to return back to, places you played before?
Yeah, very excited to get up to Canada and get to Montreal and Toronto. We're playing Quebec City for the first time in years, and London, Ontario as well, and yeah, it's they're just always great to us up there. It's gonna be really fun to go up there.
Where was I? So Parallax 2, Future Sequence, came out 2012, right? So it's a concept driven album, which really seems to make sense for a band that's as diverse as you are musically. Do you think the band was always kind of heading in that direction to kind of go more concept driven?
Yeah, absolutely. For me personally, a lot of my favorite records have, you know, a consistent story throughout them, and the music is all tied in, and it's a structure that, you know, personally I'm very invested in and is very important to me, and it was very fun to do it, and you know, be able to really expand on the concept idea, which we kind of like toyed with on Colors. But that wasn't conceptual lyrically, so we had this pretty gnarly story for this one, and it was really fun to write to, just because, you know, we could, the music could just be all over the place, you know, and have up and down dynamics, and you know, it was cool.
Is the writing process a lot more difficult? Do you have to be more conscious of kind of the different emotions of each song, or developing a storyline?
Sort of, you know,
lyrically.
Yeah, you know? It's just, you know, you kind of get to thinking in terms of a whole record and not just song to song. I feel like, you know, you tend to have just a natural flow to the album a little bit better than when you're just worrying from song to song, you know. Some of our records, you know, I wouldn't want to play start to finish just because they don't have the flow, like, mm-hmm. You know. So it's, whenever we play that set, when we play the whole new record, it's great, because it usually goes by pretty fast, you know?
Do the fans respond well to you playing it all the way
through?
Yeah,
definitely. And we're doing it a few days on this tour, just in areas where we hadn't been on the last one, so yeah, it'll be fun.
I know you guys, in 2013, you went on the road with Coheed. Mm-hmm. What was it like playing in a Radio City Music Hall? I remember seeing the flyer for that, and I was like, I can't believe Between the Buried and Me are going to be
It was pretty surreal. It was definitely, like, weird and pretty different. It was weird and different, but it was pretty magical, you know, to be there. It was definitely, like, a really cool vibe. Just standing on stage, I mean, there's, like, four or five balconies there. It was insane, and... You know, we dressed up really nice for the show. We were wearing, suits, dress pants. You know, it was fun. Felt like we were desecrating the place with the music we were playing, so we might as well look nice.
Do you think you might be the heaviest band in the history to play in that venue?
Potentially, yeah. Seriously, yeah.
Maybe. Probably ever again.
Probably.
What was it like going on the road with Coheed? Obviously, they're really a very concept-driven band. Was there kind of a parallel there?
I think so, yeah. I think all the bands on that package, because Russian Circles opened, I think musically it was a very interesting bill. And Coheed's kind of like, they have like progressive rock elements and stuff to their music. So that's cool. I think there were definitely some crossover fans and definitely a whole lot of new fans. So hopefully our music stuck with a couple of them.
So you came into the band in 2005, right? Mm-hmm. So you came in right before Alaska was recorded?
That was pretty much the first order of business. You know, I came down, played around with Paul for a little bit, and then we just started sharing ideas. And, then before you knew it, we were all in the room together at Blake's house writing the record. And that was different, you know, basically going from, like, not really knowing people to all of a sudden being in a room writing music together, which was kind of crazy. But it worked. We got through the record. You know, it's an interesting listen. But, you know, we've had the same lineup ever since. So obviously, you know, it was meant to
something be. Something worked, right?
Yeah, and I think we really gelled on Colors. That's when, you know, things really clicked. So since then, everything's been good.
A lot of the other staffers from my site were just begging me to ask you because they were all huge fans of The Anatomy Of. They want to know if there's any chance that you guys would ever do any more cover songs or if you're still... I mean, obviously, you want to be writing your own music, but is there...
Oh, I'm always open to the idea. Yeah, there's, you know... It was a fun thing, you know. We played a handful of them live, and that was always really fun, you know, playing Bicycle Race or whatever. The last cover we did, actually, when we were in Europe... when was that? 2012, fall 2012, okay. We were playing the second half of Bohemian Rhapsody live, which was really fun.
See, now, is that fun or is it intimidating trying to play Queen?
No, it's really fun.
Yeah?
Big influence, yeah.
It's crazy how his vocal range really worked that well with that song I heard, and I was just blown away.
Yeah, Tommy pulled it off great.
Is it hard kind of rewriting songs like that and kind of meshing it into your own... kind of genre?
We didn't really do that so much, I don't think. We did that with a couple songs. That's my only regret. I wish we had done that more. I wish we'd really made the songs more our own thing.
A little more.
But it was still fun.
So you guys are going to be recording an in-studio DVD in March, right?
Yep, absolutely.
Could you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, we're going to be at a really nice studio in North Carolina called the Fidelitorium. And... yeah, it's just a format that we thought was different. You know, we did the live concert show with Colors. Mm-hmm. That was fun. It was really stressful, but it was fun. It was an extremely fun show. Probably my favorite show we've ever played. You know, we thought it'd be good to take it down a lot and really just have us in a room. Very intimate. We're going to have a lot of auxiliary musicians, a string quartet, horns, percussion, all kinds of stuff going on. All kinds of friends that we're bringing in, so it's going to be a lot of fun.
So how do you recruit the other musicians that you decided to play with for this?
Well, my friend Walter, he plays in a band with me called Trioscapes, and he plays saxophone and flute, and he played both on our record. He was able to get me in touch with the right people about the string quartet, and... we reached out to a few other friends that we knew. Actually, the original drummer of the band, Will Goodyear, is going to be on the DVD doing percussion and stuff. And he works with the marching band at NC State.
That's awesome.
So I think he might be bringing up some of those players, too. Yeah.
Definitely an eclectic group.
Mm-hmm. You know, the whole point is to make it a live thing. So, yeah, it, it'll definitely be a little different, you know.
Aside from the DVD you've got coming up, do you have any plans for a new Between the Buried and Me album?
Yeah, we're going to start writing music at the end of the summer. And probably go through the new year and maybe record this time next year. So, yeah.
So potentially a new record 2015?
Mm-hmm, definitely.
So you mentioned Trioscape, but you're also in another band called Orbs?
Yeah, and we just recorded, Orbs just recorded a record that's being mixed right now by Will Yip, who's done some really interesting records as of late. And yeah, I'm really excited. You know, that's, that band is really fun for me because it's with two of my absolute best friends in the world. So it's, it'll always have a special place in my heart, you know. And plus I play guitar in it, which is a lot of fun.
There's some guys from Fear Before in it, right?
Yeah, Adam. Adam, the singer, played guitar and sang in Fear Before the March of Flames. So yeah, he's great.
So it's just kind of like a group you guys just decided you wanted a side project, or how did that come together?
Oh, yeah, yeah. We were, you know, Adam and I were really close because our bands had toured together. I met Ashley because she was trying to find extra keyboard work to do, and she didn't know Between the Buried and Me had a full-time keyboardist in Tommy. And so we started, she showed me some music she had written. I was like, this is really cool. It was really dark. And we started going back and forth with stuff. And before you knew it, we were writing the first Orbs record, and I flew out to Phoenix a few times where she was living at the time, and we just banged it out, and I was like, I think I know the perfect guy to sing on this. Mm-hmm. And it took a little bit of convincing just to convince Adam that he was up to the task, and yeah, it was a lot of fun. Great combination.
For people that don't know Orbs, would you say that it's definitely different than Between the Buried and Me?
Oh, yeah, yeah, it's completely different, probably about 180 degree difference, but it's some similarities is that it's pretty atypical, even though it's like more melodic kind of weird space rock music. Mm-hmm. You know, it's still melodic, but it's weird. You know, Adam's a very charismatic frontman.
Yeah.
Tells very interesting stories, and you know, it's just fun. I'm excited for people to finally hear the record, and yeah.
Are you going to be going out on the road with them, you think?
Definitely. I'm not sure when, but yeah, cool. At some point.
So you've been in Between the Buried and Me for almost a decade already, and it's been a band for longer than that. Obviously, what you've been doing recently has been some of the best stuff you've ever done. Is there anything that you guys haven't done yet that you'd like to do in the future, or anything that you guys are planning?
The kind of musicians we are, we're always trying to get better at our instruments, be better songwriters. For me personally, I'm kind of on a never-ending journey of just discovering new places to go. You know, I probably get, I wouldn't say bored, but we'll say bored. I probably get bored the easiest of the bunch, you know, and I love the music that we write, but I'm always ready to, you know, see where we can go next, you know, and I love the Parallax 2 record, but I do already have ideas of some things to do on the next one, so, yeah.
Well, you said before that it's cool about Orbs is that you play guitar in that band.
Yeah.
So is it a different dynamic when you're performing to play guitar than bass, or?
Yeah, I mean, I write music all the time on guitar, you know. There were a few songs on the last BT Bam that I wrote in full, and you know, just the riffs over the years, I've always written on guitar and write my bass parts secondary. But yeah, it's much different. I'm a bigger ball of nerves on stage with Orbs playing guitar. Mm-hmm. You know, I started on guitar when I was a kid, and I played guitar, you know, in bands until I was in high school. But yeah, I've never been more nervous on stage than the first Orbs show. It was terrifying. It was fun. It was all in front of friends, but it was terrifying.
So in BT Bam, you've been playing bass all these years, obviously. It's funny, we were just talking about how you have the bass tab book upstairs, or the notebook.
Yeah.
What's the proper terminology for that?
Music tab book. Yeah.
And I was just flipping through it, and I don't play bass, but I was just intimidated by looking at it. you said a lot of fans are into playing it, but you say that you actually kind of write them for yourself, huh?
I write them for myself because I cram a lot of music into my head, and I'm always moving on to the next thing, so it leaves my head pretty soonly thereafterwards. So to go back and learn songs from Colors, which is 2007, which is 7 years ago now, you know, it's hard. So yeah, I have to dig out the book, and so yeah, it's for my own sanity and being able to remember songs.
What do you consider one of, or a few of your more difficult songs that you've written, as far as bass goes?
Right now on this tour, we're playing a song called Obfuscation that's off the Great Misdirect and is pretty difficult. It's fun. It's a lot of fun, but it's very difficult. And that's one we haven't played in a few years. So it's, you know, I felt great last night, but it, you know, definitely need to like constantly be going over parts before we actually get on stage. So that's one of the main ones. Yeah.
Anything else that we haven't mentioned that we can expect to see from Between the Buried and Me in the near future to keep our eyes out for?
No, yeah, not really. I think we're going to shut down after this tour a bit and, yeah, work on some new stuff. This is Dan Briggs from Between the Buried and Me. Thanks again for watching Under the Gun TV.